Good day and welcome to CNBC Africa in Conversation. I'm Renuka Methil, and today I'm talking to a person who needs no introduction. She's one of the world's most powerful women and also one of the world's greatest givers. When she speaks, the world listens. She's the co-chair of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, a nonprofit fighting poverty, disease, and inequality around the world. And over the last 10 years, the foundation has spent at least $10 billion to benefit sub-Saharan Africa. I'm talking to none other than Melinda French Gates, who joins us today for this conversation from Seattle. A warm welcome to you, Melinda.
Thanks for having me.
So let me dive right in and just go a little back to 2015, Melinda, when leaders from 193 countries agreed to achieve the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. There were 17 big objectives, everything from ending poverty to achieving gender equality. And your foundation has just released the annual Goalkeepers Report that tracks global progress towards these goals. There's data, there's diligence, but 7 years in, how are we doing on all these fronts? Has anything changed at all?
Well, it's fantastic these goals were set because they're ambitious, but they're also, many of them were achievable. We were making substantial progress on a number of them before the pandemic hit. But I'm sorry to say that since the pandemic hit, it has set back every single goal that was set. That's how devastating this pandemic has been to health and to livelihoods. And so we need to take that in as a world and say, wow, that's a setback, but also what's possible. And I think one of the things that still makes us hopeful as a foundation is we see the incredible progress that was made before. The under five mortality, the deaths of children under five going down, malaria going down, more people on HIV/AIDS treatments than ever before. Huge progress before the pandemic. And we believe that the innovations that exist in human ingenuity, we can make progress again. But as a world, we've got to invest now, because unless we invest now, you're going to see millions of people who do not get their livelihoods back or do not reach their full potential because of the devastating impacts.
Yes, the pandemic has exacerbated all the inequalities that existed, and especially gender equality. Your focus has always been women and girls, and women's issues in many ways are also the hardest issues to tackle. I mean, if you see, poverty itself is so sexist, and the pandemic and, you know, conflict, all the issues that we've had in Africa, all the ongoing issues have been amplified by the COVID-19 pandemic. How do you see governments in Africa? Progress remains very slow globally. Apparently, it'll take another 80 years to achieve gender equality. So we are nowhere near. It remains an unfinished business. But in Africa, especially in your work here, do you see a coalition of ideas and governments and innovations? Do you see a collaboration coming forward to kind of bridge this divide and make it easier to put women and girls at the center?
You know, I think because of the pandemic, you finally saw African leaders starting to really say, my gosh, I have to make the right investments in my country, collect the data. But you also saw a coming together of the AU saying, okay, you know, when President Ramaphosa took the reins of the AU, he said, look, we've got to look at these pieces. We've got to look at gender-based violence. We have to look at girls' education. We have to look at women's economic empowerment. So I do see leaders coming together. I see in Kenya, for instance, there finally is a time use survey, which means that we'll actually know women's unpaid labor and what's going on in the informal sector. I see in Rwanda, they have well more than 60% of their parliament are women. The head of the biggest bank in Rwanda is a woman. I see in Senegal, they've made substantial progress on under five mortality and investing in women in the health system. But none of it's enough. None of it's enough anywhere in the world. We can't wait three generations for gender equality. We've got to invest now. And when we do invest now and put the right policies, the right amounts of money, the right investments in place, we will unlock our economies. We will add trillions to the global economies, and you're going to see families healthier, more kids in school, and families reaching the full potential that they want to reach.
100%. I mean, there's definitely a world of opportunity that awaits if you put women and girls at the center. And you visited Africa in June. This was your first visit post-pandemic. What were the learnings? You mentioned some of the countries, Rwanda, Senegal. Rwanda's made great progress. It really is a great example and role model for the rest of the world. But what were the particular learnings that you had in some of the, you know, the rural innards of Africa? What were the innovations that you're seeing on the ground, in particular from young people and especially women?
So I'm seeing that cell phone that we all have in our hands now. It's not always a smartphone. Some places it's a smartphone. Some places it's the plastic phone. But I am seeing that when women get cash put in their accounts, you know, those social protection payments that governments did, when they put them in a woman's digital account, it changed her economic power. So for instance, in Niger, when women got that money on their phone, they were 70% more likely to go to the market. They bought 15% more grains. So we're seeing the protection of having it in their phone. Somebody doesn't take it. Their husband doesn't use it for something else. That's an innovation we didn't have 15 years ago in this development space. I'm also seeing, you know, young people have great ideas for business. I met a young woman in Senegal who started a company with her female business partner called e-cover. And they're collecting rubber tires from around the city that used to collect water and breed mosquitoes. They're crushing them. They're selling them to cement factories. They're using them so that the rubber goes under the pitch on the football field. And guess what? They've got orders from all over the continent now. They can't keep up. So we're seeing, like in Senegal, 31% of the businesses being created are by women, but they only have less than 3.5% of the access to capital. So we need to open capital up to women so they have it in the informal sector, but also the formal sector. So I see this incredible ingenuity and potential, but we've got to do the right things to unlock it.
And you mentioned economic empowerment. And in your report, you also talk about power. Gender equality depends on women having power, not just empowerment. Can you just elaborate on that a bit for us?
Having economic power means that you have resources in your hand, wherever they come from, informal sector, formal sector, but you have them in your hands. You have them in a private way that's specific to you, and you get to spend them the way you think is right. So often women know that the right thing to do is to spend it on more food for their family or to buy a bicycle for the child who needs it to get transported to school or to put their kids in school. When you can make a decision about your own resources and you have them, that's economic power. And women spend their resources differently. So we need to make sure that women are supported in the right ways to have digital money at their disposal.
And also supported in terms of caregiving infrastructure. I mean, they cannot go to work if they don't have the right infrastructure in place, which also brings me to the question of childcare and the right healthcare. And Africa is lagging in terms of quality healthcare for women, especially in the rural areas. Of course, we've had telemedicine and all of those, all of that new technology come up in the pandemic. But in your own visits to these rural areas, what is the uptick that you're seeing for healthcare for women in rural areas?
Women are demanding healthcare. They know they need it. They're saying, my gosh, I have to walk so many kilometers to get even decent healthcare, or I get there and the supplies aren't there. But again, an innovation that I saw in Rwanda was a company called Babel, where women can call in on their cell phone and ask questions. There's a whole symptom tractor. They talk to a nurse. If needed, they talk to a doctor. And the other thing they can do is young girls are calling in and asking about their sexual and reproductive health. and where they can get access to contraceptives. So that privacy and then knowing where to go, that's an innovation that takes some of the pressure off the health system. So you don't have, and for a young woman or a woman who's pregnant, they don't have to stand in line as much because some of that can be handled over the phone. And then when you show up, the nurse doesn't have, or the doctor, such a huge caseload. So we're seeing innovations there that can help. And then you're absolutely right. On the caregiving side, I see it in my own country and I see it across the continent of Africa. Whether you're a female scientist, I met several, many impressive ones in Senegal. They're saying, I could only go get my doctorate degree because there was a childcare solution available to me, or the place that I'm working, I'm demanding childcare on site. We have to solve the childcare crisis. If we want women to work, they want to work, they have to have a safe and affordable place to put their children.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think we need homegrown African solutions for some of Africa's problems. You've mentioned investments, but the foundation, what kind of investments are you putting in going forward to kind of enable some of these healthcare and financial innovations?
Well, we've put money into the World Bank Trust Fund that is specifically for childcare innovations. And so, for instance, one of the places that entrepreneurs have come forward is, there's a company I met, a woman I met virtually during the pandemic, Sabrina, who started something called Kidogo. And in Kenya, they have 12,000 families using these small childcare centers or creches that are out in the informal settlements. She has set up female entrepreneurs to care for children, to earn an income, and it's a franchise model that's going around Kenya. That is something that can be spread beyond just Kenya, but to other countries. So I love seeing a female-led business that she created. She's creating other, what she calls mamapreneurs, and yes, she's solving a problem in society so that women can go and work and have a safe and affordable place to put their children. It's incredible.
I mean, I like that word, mamapreneurs.
There's
so many in Africa. But, you know, sitting in the U.S., Melinda, what's the kind of buzz that Africa is generating, especially African entrepreneurship? There's a lot of talk about innovation. I don't know if most of those investments are even coming into Africa, but what's the buzz around African ingenuity and innovation at the moment right now?
Well, I think we need to remind people that there's this vibrancy in Africa. And we are seeing it in the cultural space. Like, you see it through the music. People are being exposed to it, and amazing African artists. We need to remind people that, you know, what stimulates business? Having access to capital. We haven't solved that in the U.S. yet. There is access to capital for men, but women still in the U.S. have trouble having access to capital. As we open that up, we need to remind people that in emerging markets, low and middle income countries across the continent of Africa, there are amazing ideas, and we need to have access to capital there too. Again, in Senegal, I met a woman who'd started an accounting business. She sold it to one of the big eight accounting firms, and she'd started a women's investment club. And she was not only teaching women how to start a business, but she was making sure they had access to capital. I've seen the same thing in other places, like in Kenya. Those are all ways we can start to seed that entrepreneurial spirit that people already have and make sure their businesses get funded and started.
Yeah, sure. I mean, unfortunately, it is the unfortunate reality that there is a lot of gender bias in the investment landscape in Africa, where there's a lot of investments that go to male-led funds or male-led companies, but not really for women. And I think that's just a barrier that we have to overcome, and hopefully we will be able to in the coming years. But how do you think industry or the private sector, the business world, the billionaires of Africa, you know, industry leaders need to start thinking differently to sort of channel those investments to purposes that are very imperative, not just for Africa, but for the world? And in bringing women up to scale, you're actually doing, the world is going to do better. It just makes smart economic sense.
I think as we now finally have data and are collecting data about women, people are waking up. Presidents, prime ministers, heads of companies are starting to realize that, oh my gosh, I sell more product if I have women at the creative table creating products that benefit everybody, not just males in society, right? So we have to make sure they all come together and they start to see that their business is going to be better off. The economy, we actually know we can grow the economy by trillions of dollars if you help bring women into the formal sector, right? The only way to bring women in the formal sector is to make sure they have a solution for their childcare needs. We do, as a world, expect women to care for the children. But unless they have safe and affordable childcare, they can't take that great accounting job. They can't take that great tech job. They can't work in media. So we got to have that solution for them if we're going to draw them in. And in the informal sector, there are so many things we can do to make sure they have access to credit, to make sure that women are seen and are on registers so we know that they're, you know, who they are and where they've been born and where they die. Having data on women's lives is imperative, and it's something we can all contribute to.
True. And in the Goalkeepers report, Bill Gates writes about the war in Ukraine that has shown that hunger can't be solved just with humanitarian assistance alone. There should be investments in agriculture, R&D, and this is where climate change also enters, and it is the largest threat to food production, especially in Africa. Now, what kind of innovation, or rather innovative thinking, is needed in Africa to address the current food crisis that we have and to increase agricultural productivity, Melinda?
If you can there's absolutely a food crisis. The hunger that is just growing across the continent. That's because 14 African countries rely on wheat from Ukraine and Russia to feed, you know, the population. So what do we need to do? First of all, we absolutely have to give humanitarian aid. People going hungry today, and of the people going hungry, 150 million of them are women who are food insecure. Of all the people who are food insecure, 3 out of 5 are women. And women decide who eats in the family, first, second, and third. So we have to address the humanitarian crisis. And as is pointed out in the report, we've got to build the food systems. Yes. So there are seeds that are drought resistant. There are seeds that are flood resistant. The rains are coming more often in a deluge. There are seeds that deal with crop problems like wheat rust that you get in Ethiopia, and being able to predict that. Using those innovations that have come and making sure they get out in the seed system and that they reach not just male farmers, but also female farmers. 50% of the farmers are also women. If you get this whole system working right, Africa can actually feed itself. And so that is what needs, we need to get the whole system working right so it works for each country and for the continent. And it's completely possible.
It is. What do you think is excites you most about Africa today? I mean, it's the youngest continent on the planet. You must have met a lot of young people in your travels here. But we'd like to hear from you, the African youth. What is exciting about the future of this continent for you?
It's seeing young people saying, I not only want to reach my full potential, I can, and here's how I'm going to do it. You know, they've gotten themselves by hook or by crook an education, right? Or enough education that they say, I want to start this business. And so there's this entrepreneurial spirit that exists. I see it in Nigeria. I see it in Senegal. I see it in Kenya. I see it in South Africa. And so when you start to see these businesses created for the economy, and the young people are also thinking about climate change early, right? They see it. Their parents have lived it. They've lived it. So when you see that entrepreneurial spirit and people starting to be able to achieve their dreams, I also see young people on the continent saying, this isn't just for me. I want to do this for my generation or for those who've come before me. That ingenuity, that human ingenuity, I know is what's going to lift up the continent. And when you pair that with the innovations that they have and the ideas they have themselves, wow, you could see an incredible amount of lift coming for the continent from them.
Speaking of young people, you have young daughters as well. What do you tell them about having a voice and about bringing change?
I tell all three of my children, 2 daughters and a son, absolutely use your voice, use your education, use your intelligence to give something back to the world and lift someone else up. My youngest daughter is 19. She spent, 3 weeks in Rwanda. I was there for part of the time with her. Believe me, she saw the most remote parts of the Rwandan health system. And what does it do? It enlightens her to come back and say, how do I get my generation in the United States focused on these issues on the continent? Like, how do we make sure my generation sees what I am lucky enough to get to see in my travels and that we do something about it? And so I talk to all three of my children about using their voices and using their generation to help lift up everybody.
So you've also established Pivotal Ventures in 2015 to invest in social progress for women and people of color. Can you just tell us a little bit about that as well?
Yes. So I'm a co-founder at the foundation. I'm a trustee there. I still work there full time, plan to keep working there full time. And I set up another company in 2015 called Pivotal Ventures. And it's really about social progress in the United States, because I feel like we're the highest income country in the world, but we have not made it nearly far enough on gender equality. We're over 200 years away from gender equality in my own country, and we're not doing enough for people of color in my own country. And so that's really about social progress in the United States. And I use both tools. I use the tools that are available to me at the foundation and the global platform, and I use the tools that I have through Pivotal Ventures to deploy my resources on behalf of others.
So if you were to wear a businesswoman's hat and not think like a philanthropist, I mean, definitely we all have to think like philanthropists, but as a businesswoman, a business leader, what is the kind of advice that you would give young African female businesswomen, entrepreneurs, the entrepreneurs coming up? What are the qualities that they should have in this day and age?
I would say that you know a lot. You have a lot of, potential and ideas. Do not let anyone tell you that you can't live your dream. I think, when you're a young female entrepreneur, even in my own country or on the continent of Africa, you have a lot of people who will put your idea down or say that won't sell or I'm not going to fund you. You're going to hit barriers. Women hit far more barriers than men do. And what I want to tell you is keep going. Your idea is worth it and you know it. And you're going to find the people who are there to support you.
When are you coming next to Africa, Melinda? Will we be able to meet you?
For sometime in 2023. I need to get to Southeast Asia here at the end of 2022, but I certainly will be back on the continent. I love being there any chance I get. And I missed being on the continent during the pandemic.
There are 54 countries here. Any one country that you're really, really looking forward to that you've not visited and you do see opportunity there?
Oh, gosh, that would be like picking your favorite child. So you never do that. I think I've been to maybe at this point, 30 African countries, almost, not quite. So I'm always trying to, go to a new one just so I make sure I'm going around in different regions. But then I like to revisit certain African countries, too, just because I want to see the progress and what's possible. So we'll see.
And the cultural aspect, you mentioned African culture. Do you follow music? Do you follow the art scene?
I do. And of course, YouTube makes that incredibly easy. But then when I was in Senegal, I actually got to meet with some of the young female designers who are making new fabrics or some of the artists. And it's just amazing to see the vibrancy that's there and how they're trying to support the rest of West Africa. So I love that.
Indeed, amazing to see the vibrancy of Africa. It so is the most colorful continent at this point. Thank you for all the work that you do. Melinda French Gates, thank you for joining us today. That was the co-chair of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation joining us in conversation from Seattle. Thank you for watching and stay tuned.